During times like this, we're all looking for value. I have four red wines that come in the 15 to 20 US dollar range, and that's all coming up. Hello, hello, hello! Welcome back to Exotic Wine Travel. I am your host, Matthew Horky. Welcome back to the show where we help you drink adventurously so you can expand your palate and expand your mind. And I'm going to be expanding palates with four unique red wines that are coming at under 20 bucks. We're all tightening up a little bit. We want to find a little bit more value. So this is a little bit of an impromptu episode. I wasn't planning to shoot this kind of video, but somebody saw one of these wines on my Facebook page and asked, hey, would you do a tasting video on that? I really want to see it. Antonin, shout out to you. You know, I'm trying to change up the content on the YouTube channel, keep everything fresh, seeing what works, what you like. Tell me what you like. Let me know in the comments below. This is kind of going back to how the show started, random tasting video, just sharing some thoughts, sharing some wine and hanging out. So let's get into it. I have a personal connection with all four of these wines, and that's why I wanted to share with you. Not only are they good, but I have a story behind them. First up, we have the 26 Talias Mestre Daniel. This is the Tinto do Tarreco 2020. This is a Vinho de Taglio from Alentejo, Portugal. Really cool small producer. Only has 26 amphora in his cellar. Amphora are known as Talia in Alentejo. Alentejo, Portugal has the only appellation dedicated to wines made in amphora. Those are called Vinho de Taglio. Wine from amphora. You know, I was there a few years ago going through all these small cellars and seeing these producers keep these traditions alive. You put all the grapes, stems, and everything in this above ground amphora. When it starts to ferment, you have to wrap wet burlap bags around it so the amphora doesn't explode. And then after St. Martin's Day in November, what they do is they tap the bottom of the talia and then draw out the wines. There's reds, there's whites, there's rosé in talia. I personally usually prefer the reds, although I have tasted probably the best white that I've had is from this producer, 26 Talias. So this is a fresh wine, just tapped. This is Aragonés, which is Tempranillo, and Tinta Grossa. Let's see what we got here. In this vintage, they released a Padiette, which is basically a rosé, a blanco, a white, and a tinto, a red. I preferred the red the most. Really reminded me kind of a Beaujolais, a good Beaujolais style of wine. You're going to get some strawberries, definitely some fresh cherries, maybe sprinkle a little bit of pepper, a little bit of earthy notes on top of that. You would think because these wines are so fresh that the tannins are too hard. That's not the case. I think maybe because Alentejo is a warmer region, so the tannins are really nice. They're not grippy. They're not too drying. And Alentejo is a hot region, so they have a problem with acidity. But these wines have a nice line of acidity. This wine also has texture, a lot of soul. I think it's fantastic. This is the only wine out of the four that I don't think is widely available worldwide because the production is so small. This is also the only wine that I have a little discount code for. I'll put it in the description box from Real Portuguese Wines. I think it's only available in the EU though. Sorry to everybody else. We have the Clos Le Coutel Cahors 2019. This is mostly Malbec with a little bit of Merlot. I did a video, I'll link that up right there, or I'll link it up down below, about how to open wine with a corkscrew. And I said my favorite brand is Coutal. I'm not affiliated with the brand whatsoever. It's just a corkscrew that I like the most. Fits in my hand nicely. And it was invented by the owner of this winery. So they reached out to me and said, hey, you want to try some of our wines? I said, absolutely. Send them over. You know, when people think Malbec, they think of Argentina. And for good reason, that's kind of the country that's put the grape on the world stage. But actually, it's a French grape. It's actually one of the original blending grapes in Bordeaux. When I was first getting into wine, trying to explore, you know, on a budget, I was in graduate school. I was at a Whole Foods in Atlanta, Georgia, one of my normal haunts. And I remember going to the wine area and I bought one Malbec for 15 bucks. And I remember talking to the store associate and saying, I don't like this grape. Malbec, I just don't like it. That was after one Just one, trying it one time. This wine is brought into the U.S. by the legendary importer Kermit Lynch, which is like a giant stamp of approval. I'm not affiliated with Kermit Lynch whatsoever, but I like his selection. I think I've seen this wine in the U.S. for under $14, maybe even less than that. So it's a steal. I don't have a vast amount of experience with old vintages of this wine, but people say it ages well. I do like Cahors in general. A lot of blue fruit, a lot of black cherry, also some stemminess. And you know what I mean by stemminess is when I was a kid, I lived on a big farm, so we had forests. I would go out, pick blackberries, raspberries, and once in a while you get some green ones or some stems, you know, stuck in your mouth or even like twigs, and you have this greeny character. I think you get that a lot of times in traditional French wines, and you get that here. Don't expect a big New World fruit bomb. More medium body, kind of has a savory component to it. This is 2019, only 10 months in wood. I think it will age exceptionally well. And I think at this price point, if you want a medium-bodied, food-friendly red with some character, some earthiness, some savoriness, I think it's a good choice, and that's why I chose to show it. This is the Cantine Valpene Rosso Pietro. This is Barbera del Monferrato 2017. It's one of Italy's most commonly planted red grapes, actually. I think most of the places you'll find it, the most common places you'll find good examples are Piedmont, Italy. And Monferrato is actually on the eastern part of Piemonte, Piedmont, a little bit closer to Milan. It's an area of Piedmont that doesn't get as much press as those, you know, around Alba, around Barolo, around Barbaresco. But I was there about a year and a half ago. Looks exactly the same. Beautiful hillside vineyards, some fantastic Barberas, and these, they can be excellent. This is also, I think, I've seen for under $13-$14. Let's give this a go. It was really good when I tasted it a few weeks ago. Sour cherry, cranberry, leather, a little bit of mocha, maybe even a little bit of incense. Good Barbera is so good because it brings enough complexity to draw people in, but also enough deliciousness for most people to enjoy. You know, I bring Barbera a lot of times to a lot of casual wine drinkers, a lot of people that like to drink wine, but maybe I'm drinking with them and I want to drink something with a little more complexity too. But yet I want something approachable. And almost 100% of the time, people like Barbera. This is no different. This is the basic wine from this estate. And I think this is really nice. Complex, juiciness, fruity, delicious, really nice. And there's even a little bit of hint of leatheriness in it. Sangiovese and Barbera are among the two most food-friendly red grapes. And Barbera is very distinctive. Barbera. Barbera. Lastly, we have a wine from Crete, from Greece. This is the Manousakis Winery, Nostos Alexandros Cuvée. This is 2017, a GSM. GSM stands for Grenache Syrah Mourvèdre, but they can also have other grapes in there too, so it's a little bit confusing. I think the most famous GSM wines are probably Chateauneuf du Pape. I was on a press trip a few years ago through Cyprus, and we were at a wine bar in the capital. And I remember the wine bar owner said, "Hey, you want to taste some wines from Crete?" Wine geek in me, what am I going to say? Of course, yes. And he pulled aside some of these wines. I think the Grenache and then the Nostos Cuvée, which is a higher end wine than this. And I was really impressed. The consultant is Laurence Ferreau. She is the owner of Domaine Pigot and Chateauneuf du Pape, some really iconic wines for you wine nerds, you geeks out there. If you don't know what those wines are, do a little Google search or check those out. I think you might like them. This wine I've seen around the world, well distributed for under $20. It's a little bit floral, really not. Actually, this is also showing a little bit better than when I had it a little while ago. Baked strawberry, kind of dried cherry, but definitely some smoked meat type flavors. Full bodied, meaty, even a little bit of a graphite note. For a wine that's $20, I think it's the complexity is way past its price point. In terms of red wine, you have your big fruity reds, and then you have sometimes your savory reds. In between, you have wines that blend in meat, savoriness, and fruit, and I think that's what GSMs do. I already knew these wines were good because I tasted them before. That's why I wanted to showcase them. I hope this video was helpful. Maybe the advice got you to save a little bit of money during these crazy times. So I will see you soon.
Hello, thanks for watching.
Hey, you made it to the end. Make sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel, click the bell so you know when new videos are out. If you like content like this, check out our Patreon page where you get some behind the scenes exclusive content. Thanks for watching. Cheers.
Cheers.